I would like to talk with you about third-party control. So Hank already started with trying to have a definition. And as Max said, I will give you some jokey presentation so that you have some fun in the morning to keep you awake. This is my first graph, which I carry all my life with me. And each presentation I give, you see this presentation, or this slide especially. And in this slide, you see that there is a method comparison between a new and a routine method. And this professor, I don't tell you the name, who it is, but he got an invitation for a congress to Hawaii to present the results. And as you know, most of us are not interested in this 99 points, which fits well to the correlation. But most of us are interested in that single point that failed this correlation. And that's my reason that I'm talking now about third-party control here. I have my friend Mario with me, so I have to cover also safety and errors, errors in laboratory medicine. Here we have a graph from Jay Calra from Canada. And today it was understood that mainly the problems appear in the pre-analytical and in the post-analytical phase. For me, it could be an excuse that we don't know that much about the analytical process. That's why we are finger pointing to areas outside of the laboratories. There are the problems. And in the laboratory, we believe that we have everything under control. Is this correct? So the risk, you know, CLSI is creating a new, or they did a new document, EP23, on risk management in laboratory medicine. And I looked to the risk rate in different situations. So if you're visiting a hospital as a patient, the risk to die is 1 to 300, while dying on a plane crash is only 1 to about 10 million. So for me, the preference is to go on a plane rather than to go in a hospital. Well, if I'm a patient, I wouldn't go on the plane, but that's a different story. The impact of the laboratory results to clinical decisions, that's very important for me because I see over the years the impact is growing. So 94, the impact was about 64%. So 64% of a medical decision is driven by the laboratory result. Great. Nowadays, it's about 80. But on the other hand, it's so strange to me that only 5 cents of a dollar or a euro is paid for the laboratory just to provide this 80% for the background of clinical decisions. So there is a mismatch. And I think we, from the laboratory side, have to work on this to show how really important we are. Not only showing the numbers, we have to deliver cases and the evidence. Now, going back to my topic, and I start from the very beginning, it's the calibration. Calibration is a process of testing and adjusting an instrument or test system to establish a correlation between the measurement response and the concentration or amount of the substance that is being measured by the test procedure. Well, that's a definition. And we are always focused on quality, but we are not that much focused on calibration. But there, the problems may start. If I present this to students, I ask them to draw a line, and everyone starts the line at the zero point. Strange to me, if I ask you to draw a line, you can draw the line wherever you want. To draw a line, at least you have to have 2 points, then you're able to draw the line, and you believe that there is a linearity between the 2 points. It might be better to have 3 points, and then you believe that between the 3 points you have a linearity like this. But even there's a chance of non-linearity. So at the end, your calibration curve may look like this. That's why we need to have quality control over this process. When do calibration? Both CAP and CLIA require that calibration or calibration verification be performed at least every 6 months and after reagent lot changes. And after reagent lot changes. That's what most of the laboratories are not doing. Unacceptable quality control. Unacceptable quality control doesn't mean that you have a value which is not fitting to your limits. you have to find a reason for it before you do a calibration. These days, people very often look at the quality control result and then they do the calibration and calibrating the error. We don't remember the error any longer. And I will show you some consequences out of this. So major service of the instrument require calibration and for sure when recommended by the manufacturer. The calibration cost on the treatment. Here I have an example from the States on calcium. So if you don't do a proper calibration on calcium, cost us about annually $60 to $199 million this error because of additional investigation of the patient and maybe wrong or misleading treatment. So calibration verification means the assaying of material of known concentration in the same manner as patient specimens to substantiate the instrument or test system's calibrations throughout the reportable range for patient result, test results. And this is representing the quality control. Today we have mainly closed systems. So the manufacturer delivers due to the IVD directive, so regulations, a system which is the instrument, the reagent, the calibrator, and the quality control. So here you have a totally closed system. And sometimes the manufacturer adjusting their quality control material where there's a calibrator, and you believe that you are in a very safe situation. The critical point in view of patient safety that all of us are fulfilling the minimal requirement. Why should I do more? On the other hand, if I go on a plane, they do the check again and again and again, and they will do it tomorrow as well, even if they know that they are very safe, they have a very high sigma level, but they do the testing again and again and again. This might be important to have such a high sigma level. But in the laboratory, we are on the way to reduce the number of control checks we are doing. So typically, we are running two QC samples in the morning, that's fine. And we believe that about 1,000 samples per day or even more are safe under quality control. Creatinine method, which we're using today. Here we have a nice experiment, 365 samples from patients with 90 different diseases were sent out to different procedures to measure creatinine, where there's a reference procedure. So we have four enzymatic and three Jaffe procedures compared against the reference procedure. And you see that here about 16% of the measurements are critical biased. So in the enzymatic procedure, you see 6% have a negative bias, while three have a positive bias, and the Jaffe procedure, well, that's known. No one is using the Jaffe procedure any longer. It's a 100 years old method, but it's cheap. It's cheap, but it's creating a high number of errors, and we are reporting those errors. And finally, the healthcare economy has to pay for this. Lot-to-lot variation. Here is an example showing the glucose measurement on different lots of one manufacturer. And you'll see that if you have a lot change, also your target value, your quality control target value may change. This is not only true for quality control material, it's well true for patient material. The way we are doing in the laboratory might be like this. I'm shooting now against the dark and we will see what happens. First, second, third, fourth, fifth, thank you, sixth. And our conclusion. On average, the dark is dead. Independent quality control for me is an absolutely neat. And here I brought an example from one laboratory. They do sodium measurement and they use the instrument control fluid over the time and it looks very nice. So the high control and the low control fits very well to their limits and they are very happy about this. But unfortunately, they got a phone call from the physician and the physician told them that he is not happy with the sodium results, they are too high. Well, we have nice quality control. Both are very well in the limits. So there is nothing wrong in the laboratory. There might be something wrong with the drawing of the sample or whatever the physicians are doing. Well, in this case, it happened that they did a calibration at that point. And you see, if you calculated the mean of a third-party control over the time, you see that there is a shift. So the physician told you that there is something wrong with your procedure. If you have had used here a third-party control, you were able to detect this. Well, you explained the reasons and the differences. Another tool which you can use is the patient mean, and the patient mean represents exactly what the third-party control shows you in this example. Well, the calibration is the issue, and the failure that people did is that they used the same pipette for the controls as for the calibrators. Very convenient, but if there is an error in the pipette, you transfer this area, this error as well into your quality control material. That's why you need to have a third-party control, and especially in this case, a liquid one will overcome the problem with the pipetting, because most of us are not lyophilizing patient material. Long-term studies, and here I have a study which ran over 7 years on glucose, and they detected a shift over the years. It seems that the values in this study group gets higher, 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 but the reason was the manufacturer modified the calibration over time. So the wrong conclusion out of this, the wrong clinical conclusion, is that there is getting worse with the glucose getting higher in this population, but this was just a problem of calibration of the instrument. So the recommendation of FDI is ideally QC material simulate the composition of patient samples as closely as possibly in order to minimize matrix effects and correctly reflect the expected performance, which you may see on patient samples. Use of matrices such as human serum, urine, or whole blood-derived samples may be accomplished this. My question is, and that's the wish of the laboratory, one fits all. Did you ever saw a patient who suffered from a broken leg, myocardial infarction, hepatitis, HIV, osteoporosis, leukemia, gallstones, hyperthyroidism, pancreatitis, kidney malfunction, high age, prostate carcinoma, and is pregnant at the same time? Well, that's the quality control which we want to see, a control which has all the analytes in extremely high concentration. Maybe it's time to ask for disease-specific controls, because we are taking care of patients and we don't pool the patients and deliver them the results. So my conclusion, calibration is a critical step in the analytical process. Matrix effects have to be taken into account. There is an absolutely need of an independent control material, third-party control, given by ISO 15189, and you reduce the risk of unreliable results. And finally, you save lives and money by using independent quality control material. That's why on the plane you do the checks, that over again and over again. That's why we need this for the laboratory as well. My very last slide is, thank you for your attention.